All right. Thanks everyone for coming today. I'm going to talk about a really fun, sexy, fun topic. Power BI governance. It's about as good as it gets. So building and implementing a governance strategy from self-service to enterprise. So I get a little wordy with my decks, so I'm going to get as granular as we possibly can here. So, and again, if we have some time at the end, feel free to ask some questions. Just a quick overview of the session itself. As you know, organizations are experiencing a lot of missteps when implementing Power BI. Lack of strategic governance, really a lack of a power user strategy, lack of a roadmap, just a few examples. I'm gonna cover a lot of different ways to ensure that from several hundred Power BI implementations that I've been involved in, that we can put some things in place to ensure that doesn't happen to you or to your clients or to whatever effort you might be working on in Power BI. And with that, I'm gonna talk about some things that maybe are not talked about a lot, like Power BI chargeback models or Power BI Center of Excellence, but gonna try to get as granular as possible. And again, if you have any questions, just raise your hand and I'll try to answer them. So quick background on myself. I am the founder and chief Power BI architect of EPC Group. I founded the company 22 years ago. I am the author of 4 Microsoft Press books. I started out as a SharePoint guy back in 2000, 2001 on this fancy project called Project Tahoe, and then they renamed Tahoe to SharePoint. So it's funny how this governance topic came along. I almost have these flashbacks of SharePoint back in 2003, 2004, and how SharePoint governance is a little eerily similar in certain ways to Power BI governance these days. So, you know, talking about how to surface Power BI reports in SharePoint or Office 365 or a lot of different types of platforms itself. And again, pretty cool offering. We just are launching powerbitraining.com. So you may have seen like Udemy or Lynda or some of those online training sites. So we thought, you know, there's a lot of different ways folks are taking training, but wouldn't it be cool to have some beginner, advanced, intermediate ways to go out there and just take some classes in your pajamas or on the weekends or at your desk. So it's kind of a cool new offering. One thing I should mention too, have some folks in the back, and let me just grab the flyer here. So as part of this, Microsoft has been very supportive on the new book, the new Power BI book that came out in December. I'm having a book signing after this in the reception area, so get some booze and get a signed book. Also, we're giving away three months of Power BI training.com to anyone who wants to sign up. So we're launching it in the fourth quarter and thought it'd be a great way to launch it here at the conference, and you know, feel free to give your feedback and we'll just kind of grow it from there. So. With that being said, let's jump right in. So what can happen? You know, lack of Power BI governance, cause and effect. And so I work every day, all day in Power BI implementations. And so really taking clients' needs, CIOs, IT directors, CFOs, all sorts of different IT folks that may have different kind of needs. And so it's interesting to be able to sit there and just talk about what they're trying to accomplish, issues they might be having, missteps that have happened. And so what really can happen with a lack of Power BI governance? And so clients to remain nameless, a large hospital system allowed content to be shared across all medical practitioners within the healthcare platform itself, healthcare system. It was not a HIPAA violation, it wasn't a PII violation, but at the same time, it was not good. And so again, lack of security, lack of governance can really put a damper on things. The project was put on hold, had to do a root cause analysis to try to find out what exactly happened. And after 3 months of kind of figuring out what exactly was the cause, reverse engineering that, fixing it, they were able to continue. So they brought us in after the fact, but again, Power BI governance is so key. Another project, client came to us and said, well, all of a sudden our HR data is open to everyone. Everyone can see what everyone is making, salaries. So from the CEO to the CFO to IT, data was out there. And so then folks exported it and saved it in SharePoint and saved it in Teams and had chats about it. So Yeah, so it's very real, very painful, but very real. So lack of Power BI governance, you know, what else can happen? So security breaches, security by obscurity is not an option. What I mean by that is we had a client that had a lot of different branches, and they wanted to be able to secure the content by having a little GUID in there and be able to, well, let's just protect it that way. And so again, I'll get into some more, you know, more granular pieces, but we just want to make sure that security by obscurity is not an option here. Data privacy, regulatory violations, HIPAA, PHI, PII, BAAs, if you're working with hospital systems, you know, who can actually access your data and what are, you know, your external policies to share? That's really important. Violations of agreement with clients, with vendors, with suppliers, with employees. You know, you might violate an NDA, an MSA, a supplier agreement, an employee contract. You know, and again, not trying to scare folks, but it's really important to put Power BI governance. And again, this is not a topic that people want to invest in. It's not a topic that people want to always take seriously. But I can't stress enough how important it really is. We've had clients come to us and say, "Well, we had a supplier portal, and the data was shared, and our bill rates were shared, and profit margins were shared, and we lost a second phase of the project because of that." And so, this isn't all about, you know, security, but it's important just to think through the things that can happen, the things that can go wrong, and we're just make sure that we put some things in place here to make sure that doesn't. Decreased usage and the ultimate failure of Power BI within the company. Folks may be looking for another alternative. I don't even know if we're allowed to say the word Tableau here at this conference, but we definitely, you know, don't want folks to do that. Power BI governance model. You know, what is it at a high level? Again, defines your organization's procedures, people, practice, policies, technology. I sound like Marcos Lemonis on The Prophet. You know, people, practice, processes. Standard stuff, but then we take that at a high level and let's break it down a little bit. So get a little more granular. And so we have the vision of the Power BI usage, an outline of the roadmap, strategic and operational governance policies. You know, take the business side and the functional side, marry those together. Don't just think technical, don't just think business side. They gotta work together. You know, again, ensure the ability to secure your data, provide confidence to the users. Establishing rules for your organization's data usage. There's some awesome new auditing capabilities in Power BI. Ways to, you know, access and find out what exactly is going on, who's accessing what, when. You know, also how compliance data is handled. Again, don't mean to harp so much on compliance, but you know, if you are in a hospital system or you work with financial institutions or banks or, you know, those types of industries, which in some shape or form most clients and companies do, you got to follow that. There's some really bad things that can happen as far as penalties. And so we want to secure for both internal and external data sharing. And we want, you know, I call governance almost like the rules of the game. How do we play the rules of the game? Repeatable rules of the game, compliance, monitoring, auditing. We want to reduce the risk and overall cost of ownership of Power BI. And that's what governance can do. I remember back in 2003, 2004, when I was doing SharePoint governance, and nobody wanted to do SharePoint governance at the time either. And things weren't planned right. You know, the wild, wild west is a joking term I hear a lot in SharePoint, and we just don't want that to happen to Power BI. We want to improve communication between team members. You know, everyone singing from the same sheet of music. And so permission models, you know, access management, information security strategies, really the process for provisioning new Power BI reports. This is something also that's not talked about a lot is, okay, we want a Power user or someone to create a new Power BI report. Well, what are the naming conventions? What are the approved visualizations? What are the approved branding elements? You know, this isn't a SharePoint Online branding effort where we're creating master pages and we don't have corporate communications involved. But at the same time, it's got to follow a corporate strategy as far as these kind of branding elements, the deployment strategies. You know, we're not dealing with on-prem dev test prod back in the day, but we still need to have a deployment strategy, obviously in Azure or whatever cloud-based implementation, or maybe it's a hybrid type platform. And then approved data sources. What integrations are going to be allowed? What data sources should be restricted? We'll talk about that a little bit here in a minute. But and then something that is just so important is Power BI support and training. It's just no company spends enough money on end user adoption and training. They just don't. And I wish they did, and but at the same time, you know, folks want to get the project going, they want to get out there, they want to do some train the trainer, and then folks get busy and they're on to the next project, right? So with that, we just really want to enable end user support. We want to enable train the trainer. Really, what's the short and long-term training strategy of the company? You know, not all companies are big enough to have a corporate training director. You know, sometimes it's led by IT, it's led by different departments out there that might have paid for Power BI or want Power BI to kind of take hold. And so we really want to big time put an emphasis on support and training, end user adoption. That's going to make sure the project is successful. That's going to get you your next phase. You just don't want that to fail. And so governance, you know, let's get a bit in the weeds, get a little more technical and talk about data sources, right? What are the suggested data sources? What are the connection modes? Why would certain data sources be restricted? Are we talking on-prem SQL? Are we talking cloud-based SaaS implementations? Is it a hybrid of many different implementations, many different types of data? Are we talking about Excel flat files all over the place? Probably all of those things. So most implementations cover all those. You gotta plan for those. You gotta get those right the first time. You know, I always joke that you gotta put buckets in place. You may not want to do it right now, but it's how to lay the foundation, how you put the plumbing in, the electrical, the water lines, so that when you're ready to go to the next phase, you don't have to knock the back wall out to build a porch kind of situation. So that's really important to scale it right the first time, plan for it right. What are your licensing policies? You know, what is the use of app workspaces? What content packs are you using? You know, Power BI report creation. I talked about it a few minutes ago, but you know, what is the client distribution and what are the updates? You know, I know we all get that annoying update to, you know, it's time to update Power BI desktop. Power BI has a new version. I know every time I have a client demo and I'm running behind, all of a sudden it pops up and I have to update my my version. So. And also, how are PBIX files handled? Where are they stored? I mentioned naming conventions, version history. You know, this isn't back in the TFS world as far as code and code, you know, code management. There's different ways to do code management and, you know, code management in Power BI. But I think not enough people are talking about that, and that is really important to do that. And so getting into, did I miss one there? Data model, usage, reports, what is your mobile and or tablet strategy and or the distribution management of those usage policies? I think it was interesting on the keynote this morning, they talked about, I think it was Atlantic Airlines, Virgin Atlantic, they talked about, well, we don't have a mobile team, we don't do a lot of mobile development, and a lot of companies don't. It's a very specific skill set. We have, you know, iOS, we have Android, we have emulators that we can use to do that, but what's nice about this is it has the app, the Microsoft updates it, we don't necessarily have to maintain it, but we still have to govern our reports and our visualizations so they're gonna be mobile compatible. You know, think back kind of responsive web design, right? If we're doing SharePoint Online sites, or we're doing a website, or we're doing whatever else it might be, responsive web design. Still think in that same mindset when you're doing Power BI, even though again, there's not as strict of limitations, it's still important. Simple things too, like you know, what integrations are allowed, what are your embedding policies, gateway management, who owns it, who can we call if it goes down, you know, what are some repeatable processes for the configuration, as well as monitoring. You know, with Power BI Embedded coming out, a lot of organizations want to say, hey, we want to use Power BI Embedded, we want to put it in our fancy application, and we want to provide it to our clients. You know, that's a whole nother set of governance policies and a whole nother set of concerns. They don't have to be bad concerns, but a whole nother set of things you want to think about when it comes to Power BI Embedded. And I think Power BI Embedded is going to take off like crazy. And so we really want to think through not only, you know, the standard Power BI or, you know, Power BI Premium or Power BI some on-prem stuff, but let's think through all the different options and bucket it, even though we're not doing it in phase one or even phase two. So, some other pieces, scheduling reviews and updating your Power BI governance strategy. A lot of companies will get a template, update their governance strategy, save it out there, it's version one, never look at it for another 6 months. That's just not the way that needs to happen. the same time, who's funding this Power BI governance fancy, sexy project? No one probably, or IT to some extent. So we want to be able to have someone, and I'm going to harp on Power BI power users, but we really want to have someone maintain the Power BI governance strategy. And you know, going back to the SharePoint world and to Office 365 and on some of the beta teams I was on back in the day on those teams, you know, people would just create the SharePoint governance strategy, throw it out there, and again, never look at it again. So we want to be proactive around it. We want to really make sure that we're on top of it. It's an exercise. Put it on your calendar every 3 weeks. Sit down for an hour and a half with your Power BI team and say, okay, guys and gals, we're going to go through it. We're going to maintain it. What's changed? What's new? All this good stuff. So put some time into it. It's going to pay off in the long run. It really will. And as far as you know, what must be developed with all, as far as the stakeholders, make sure all the stakeholders are involved. Don't just have one or two people that may have some time put together governance and everybody just kind of rubber stamp it. Try to vet it. You know, have an approval process. Throw a flow on it. You know, make it somewhat fun if you can. Then going through, you know, clear escalation path as far as governance strategy. If it goes wrong, who do we talk to? What data sources are allowed? Standard stuff, Excel, SQL Server, SharePoint, CSV files, some Microsoft Azure-based app, SaaS-based applications, you know, Dynamics, Salesforce, SAP, all the usual suspects. You know, how do we ensure that we're connecting to these data sources? How do we have these kind of pipelines, right? Think of this foundational kind of mindset. You have all these pipes coming into the foundation, and how do you then turn on your Dynamics 365 pipe, and how do you turn on your SQL pipe, and how do you maintain it? And then the data freshness around it. Is it real time? Is it every 4 hours? Is it X amount of times a day? You know, all the things you got to almost reverse engineer as you think through it. And then my personal favorite topic, no joke, is Power BI power users. You know, this is a real game changer. It's just such a difference Power BI power users can make in an organization. And so if we're talking about a Power BI power user strategy, what does that look like? A successful strategy can really make or break an implementation, and I'm not joking. I say they can, but they need to set up and champion an internal Power BI user group. Set up a monthly group. Have the folks that are passionate about Power BI come. Have your own little, you know, company XYZ user group. Why not? Have them come out there, bring donuts, bring breakfast, you know, get to wear jeans on Friday, cool t-shirt, whatever, but make it happen. You know, provide some monthly training to your organization's power users. One thing we really like to do is to get the folks together and then record it. And then, whether it's Teams or WebEx or Skype for Business or whatever it might be, record it and then throw it up on stream or on a SharePoint side or a Teams channel. And so you have repeatable training that you can then go back to and watch. And then also, when you're onboarding new users, when folks are coming onto the company, make it part of the HR process. Okay, you guys got to go out there and you got to, guys and gals, you got to watch this 30-minute training video, or every 3 months, they need to go back and rewatch the training. It's just really nice to be able to kind of have this repeatable training that you can build internally that's tailored to your data. Folks have already signed the NDAs, so it's actually your content. You don't have to worry about sensitive data getting shared or going out there. You know, kind of refresher courses. And so also assist in quickly fielding access requests. Think of these power users being kind of like your first line of defense. People don't always want to call IT. Business folks sometimes get turned off by IT people. I don't know why. But you know, people want to go out there and say, you know what, let me call the power user. He or she's a little easier to talk to. They get me, they work in the business. Let's have them be kind of the first line of defense to be able to support us. And then also have those folks identify future or additional power users. So as your Power BI implementation grows, you're going to need more power users. You're going to need more super users, whatever you want to call it. But these folks are just, they're worth their weight in gold if you can train them right, get them passionate about it. And then have, as you have this kind of monthly get together, have each department demo what they're doing. Hey, what's HR doing? What's IT doing? What's marketing doing? Well, Jill's got this awesome new graph, and the light bulb comes on. People don't even realize, well, I didn't know we could do that. Let's try that. And then that just organically builds the inertia of really Power BI. It's pretty amazing. And then again, first line of defense I talked about. Again, just harping on power users a little bit more, but you know, they can help answer a lot of standard questions. How many folks say, well, why don't I have a Power BI license? I don't understand why I don't have one. You know, have them field those kinds of questions. They need to be prepared to answer some of those loaded questions. They can assist in, you know, why would my current Excel report possibly look like in Power BI? You know, have them be prepared to do some mock-ups or some demos or some little proof of concept. I know they probably have another job, a day job, and they don't necessarily have time to possibly do all of this. But if they can be your kind of your champion, your first line of defense, it's going to be really nice. And also, if you have a new department that's coming in and they want to be able to, hey, we're interested in Power BI, we heard great things about it, have one of your power users come in and sit down and talk about all the cool things that you can do and maybe have them demo it. Sometimes IT demoing things to folks is not as nice as having a business person demo something to you, you know? Try to take the technical off of it and make it more business, business terms. So, a couple other elements, you know, roles and responsibilities, metrics, and kind of what we're taking a look at here. You know, you guys have probably seen different flavors of this, guys and gals, different flavors of this. But you know, there's is a roles and responsibilities, you know, RACI, whatever you want to call it. And this can change. Sometimes the same person might be three or four of these roles, right? And so when you're looking at this, think, okay, well, who's the overall executive sponsor? Maybe it's the CIO, the CFO, the IT director. Maybe it's, you know, some business unit that didn't like their manual Excel reports getting lost and wanted to do something more automated. You know, it could be a lot of different things. That's why Power BI is so different than SharePoint or Teams or, you know, Office 365's other applications or some of the other pieces. It's just very unique, its own little kind of its own little animal, and folks get so passionate about it because it's their data. This is the lifeblood of the organization. And so people really do get attached to Power BI. And so if you can do it right the first time, people are gonna like it. It's gonna grow legs. Again, application owner, I listed some of these twice because sometimes it's gonna be multiple folks, you know, the business analyst, the power user, someone who's gonna own the infrastructure, someone who's going to be an IT security owner or manager, standard end user, mobile experience owner, maybe someone who's going to manage or assist with the mobile elements, and then a BI developer, someone who's doing predictive analytics or DAX or all the fancy stuff out there. So if we're taking a look at delivery approaches in Power BI, this is pretty standard stuff, right? Self-service BI versus enterprise BI, the two different sides of the arena. Self-service, which is hard to do, bottom-up approach, analyze the users, analyzing using any type of data source, emphasis on data exploration, the business supports it. It's hard to make that work unless you have some folks that are passionate about it and you're going to put some time in to work with them. Enterprise BI is a lot easier because you have a mandate from it. You have the C-level folks or IT directors or whoever it might be pushing this down, and so you know, IT supports all the elements of the solution. That's they own it, they govern it, they support it. And so, you know, if we take a look at the self-service model itself, agile self-service Power BI, it's business-driven. It allows for rapid delivery. Self-service Power BI does not mean less governance, but spelled butt wrong there, but rather freedom for users to pursue BI exploration. It also doesn't mean less secure either. So establish processes for Power BI proliferation, implementing processes to reduce risk, as both the business and IT stakeholders will be involved. So this is harder to do, but if you can do it, it's so much more powerful. You know, establishing processes for auditing Power BI. Create a gold image for Power BI power users. So if you can create a project and then save this template that already connects to your data sources and already has some cool visualizations and use that as the gold image and then give that to folks, maybe it doesn't have sensitive data or maybe it connects to a temp test, whatever set of data, and then use that to kind of, you know, help grow Power BI. And so it's kind of nice to think back in the day, you know, gold image, I'm thinking a Windows Server 2008, you know, server build gold image. Well, now we're talking maybe a PBIX file or some type of a Power BI gold image where you have all the most of the things connected, and then folks can utilize that to kind of grow. So how it can fail, I mean, it does from time to time from a self-services model. It's when it's typically not communicated enough to the audience. You know, not enough effort is made around training. Typically means the users in the organization, they haven't, you know, had the opportunity to take training, or not enough emphasis has been put on training. This leads to users reverting back to their old ways. You know, I don't get it, I'm just gonna go back to Excel and copy and paste and forget it. Your support desk may not be equipped enough to handle Power BI requests. That's something really common. Are you training the help desk or the service desk? Do they know what's going on? They know who to contact? Typically, they just say, well, it's Bob or Sandy, and they're our Power BI gurus. Let me shoot you over the request to them. It's a very typical kind of a scenario. Reoccurring issues with performance, gateway issues, no one knows exactly kind of what to hit. And so it all boils down to, you know, doing it right the first time from a governance perspective of the foundation, laying the plumbing, the electrical, the water lines, all that good stuff, and then the communication itself. How it can fail, again, licensing confusion, not enough communication, folks being concerned about data quality. Well, we did this ourselves, IT's not involved. Are we really sure this is right? You wanna make sure data quality is there, because if data quality is not there, that's the second fastest way to lose Power BI user adoption outside of security breaches or security issues. And so a lack of trust begins to build that can happen. Users may start seeing reports with incorrect dates and poor performance of the content load. And so we just don't, no matter what model we take, we never ever wanna have a lack of trust or a lack of confidence, because users will start to look elsewhere. Let's say, hey, business ABC, unit ABC is now using Tableau. Let's just wait and see how that goes, and maybe we'll revisit this in a couple months. So we wanna make sure it's done right again. When it's successful and when you have this self-service model, it's awesome. Business users will contribute directly to Power BI's development. Users know and understand the data. They'll be able to take that gold image that I talked about and take this template and then be able to quickly start developing new reports. When users are self-sufficient in Power BI, the return on investment is found quickly. It's quickly identified. It's gonna supercharge your users' adoption. Also, other departments are gonna get on board. Wow, did you see what they're doing over there? We need to try this out. You know, we own the licenses already. Well, let's give it a try. And so with that, when you have the users, kind of this self-service BI, you're gonna have solutions developed that you never planned for. You'll see kind of real innovation in Power BI, and users will begin to develop reports and think outside of the box. I'm not saying IT doesn't think outside of the box, but sometimes IT folks tend to be very kind of focused on the specific task at hand and not maybe trying to say, okay, well, how do we, where's the new math in this situation? And so, the ideal scenario is for potential problems to be identified before they actually become a problem. And so that's where we're looking and saying, okay, well, not just saying predictive analytics, but if we can get folks looking at things and saying, oh, okay, well, that number doesn't look right, let's drill down on this and be able to understand it. So, that's a nice model when done right. The standard model is typically the enterprise BI model, model number two, very traditional model, clearly defined, IT-driven policies and procedures going through. It's the most clearly defined as far as governance. It's very kind of standard. You can kind of fit it into a cookie cutter sometimes governance model. Data quality must be extremely high to meet expectations, because if it's an IT-driven project, you're probably going to have the CIO or CFO or whatever IT director or person vetting this data. So they're gonna take a look at it and say, oh, this looks right, or no, this doesn't look right. Let's get it back and make sure it's right before we roll it out. So it's more of kind of a proof of concept kind of scenario in this more enterprise BI rollout than you would get in the self-service rollout itself. And so within that, you're going through, data being accessible, but it must be secure and governed. Going through and understanding, this is the best model for business critical or mission critical reports. you know, if you have a board of directors meeting once a month, or if you have an M&A activity going on, or you have, you know, you're a publicly traded company and you're reporting financials, you don't want to have self-service BI driving those reports, right? You want to have this be done by the enterprise. This can then be farmed out, or it can then be scaled over to more of a self-service model once it's proven. But again, just some things to think about as far as, okay, well, what type of report is it? What type of data is it? What's the goal? What's the security on it? What is the data freshness? Where is it coming from? Kind of all those different things that you think of. You almost kind of reverse engineer Power BI projects as you kind of come into it. You think, okay, well, how many users is it? How many data sources are we talking about? You know, do you have 5 or 6 reports in mind that you want to start with as far as from a proof of concept perspective? You know, just kind of things I might ask any person on any initial Power BI scoping call that I'm on, kind of getting those kind of, you know, framework elements and kind of driving from there. Anything we should be aware of as far as, you know, support models, anything as far as hybrid security, e-discovery, legal issues, regulatory and compliance pieces, all those things you're going to think about when thinking about business critical reports themselves. And then again, you're going to always want to have specific team members be assigned whenever it's a mission critical report. You're going to have someone own that, or, you know, an owner and a backup person. But these reports can be created and published over a workspace or shared to the overall, you know, end user groups or the consumers or even to the executive teams. So kind of different ways to look at it, different data sources, different data sets. So any questions? Easy enough, all right. How it can fail. Users are not provided with all the reports that they truly need sometimes in the enterprise BI model. Because with this, it's, you know, IT and the executive team are pushing down very specific reports, the kind of low-hanging fruit, the ones that are very kind of passionate to them, the ones that they want to see done. You know, new custom reports take more time than expected because enterprise BI is going to focus on the reports that they had in scope at the beginning. And then as this scales, and a new user is going to request reports, and then from there, but it just takes more time to create new custom reports whenever you're dealing with more kind of the enterprise BI rather than the self-service. And then also, power users are not empowered enough to make them dangerous sometimes to get the organization's user base kind of excited, because I just see whenever we do kind of enterprise BI, again, Power BI power users just are not given enough ammo. They're just not given enough kind of time or enough budget behind them. So regardless of the model, you know, again, I'm harping on Power BI power users and user adoption, but it's just very important. And so that new math that I talked about, that thinking outside the box, that's not always driven phase one from an enterprise BI level report. And so if we take a look at establishing the Power BI system governance model, some examples, security and sharing. You know, how are reports secured and shared? Is it 80 groups in distribution lists? What about O365 groups? What are your 80 group policies? You know, do you have a clear guide as far as sharing reports in your organization? You have to have that. How do you share them internally? How do you share them externally? You know, embedded is its own little animal there as well. System usage, monitoring, auditing, some great new capabilities around this. Definitely not enough time is spent on monitoring and auditing, but you know, utilize the admin portal, access the unified audit log, create some alerts to ensure data set owners can quickly resolve any issues that might arise, get some alerts going, hook flow into it, some very cool things you can go do these days with it. Schedule some specific time to audit actions performed by users. Take a look at it, do random audits. It's important. You know, again, we get so busy, like everybody else does, just doing our kind of project work and doing our heads down stuff, but take some time to schedule, you know, every 3 weeks, spend 30 minutes, just randomly audit what's going on in Power BI. You think you might find some things that, again, may really help your initiative. Monitor your gateways, review error logs, excessive memory utilization, kind of Power BI 101 stuff, but it's still important to don't forget about that kind of stuff. And then data freshness. You know, what are your requirements around data freshness? Does that vary by data source? Probably it does. If it's specific financial data, you probably want it real time, or it's point of sale data, you want it real time. If it's month end kind of stuff, or you know, other kind of things, it may not necessarily need to be real time. It could be nightly data dumps, or it could be weekly, or every X amount of hours. But no matter what, and I mentioned it a minute ago, but there must be data source owners clearly defined who are responsible for data freshness. So if the data's not fresh, something's going on, there's gotta be an owner to that. So let's make sure that kind of we assign that. Taking a look at really a 36-month roadmap, and this is something that I started back in SharePoint back in 2001, 2002. It's just so funny how the kind of these worlds are colliding. But this Power BI 36-month roadmap, how do you put together a three-year roadmap and why? So if you take a look at this, development of this 36-month plan for the organization's Power BI implementation and the related business, you know, BI capabilities on average, and I looked at, you know, did quite a bit of research for this deck and this this number, but it's about a 20% cost savings on average. So companies that actually put together a 36-month roadmap literally are saving 20% of the cost of the effort itself. So the amount of time you might put in there to develop a 36-month roadmap may be 2 days of time, 3 days of time, but what is 24 hours of time at $70 an hour all in versus 20,000 or 20% of a $150,000 project, right? So if you take a look at the numbers and the costs, you know, these little things like this can really make a difference, and really, you know, you can put some dollars to, you know, to them and say, wow, it's actual real dollars. This includes a governance strategy and planning services spanning all components of the Power BI service. Again, kind of that people, process, technology to manage the deployment and the continued use of Power BI. You know, this roadmap is so critical. It must have a clear definition for the requirements from the business and technology. What happens if X department comes in and wants a new report? What happens if we all of a sudden get a new SaaS service and we want to hook into that and we want to create visualizations and reports from it? You know, what is the intake? What is the provisioning model? What is the deprovisioning model? You got to have it from both sides. How do you intake it? How do you cut it off? How do you manage it? How do you support it? And so there must be a clear and detailed strategy to implement the solutions when talking about, you know, meeting your overall business intelligence requirements. And so again, this 36-month roadmap is something that is just, it's almost worth its weight in gold. You match that with the Power BI, Power User strategy, your effort's probably gonna be successful. Couple other items here, you know, change management strategy, something that folks don't do enough of in Power BI. I know change management's in every IT project, but do people really focus enough on that in Power BI? It's got to have a related plan for both the internal as well as any externally required consulting services. You know, what's it going to cost? Do we need to hire X firm to come in and do some of the heavy lifting, do some of the architectural work, and then do some train the trainer off to us to get us up to speed? It's something at EPC Group we like to do is say, okay, well, we'll come in, we'll help you with some of the foundational pieces, but the more we can make you dangerous, client X, the better, because it's just gonna lower your cost of ownership, and it's gonna be, the chances of us getting a phase two are a heck of a lot higher if we're empowering our users and if we're empowering the client to be able to support themselves. They shouldn't be hooked to our wagon. They shouldn't always have to come back to us or any other firm to support themselves. And again, you know, it's just kind of, it's counterintuitive to think, well, I'm gonna let this client just have the keys to the castle and I'm gonna show them how to, you know, drive the Ferrari, put the Ferrari up for winter and how to maintain the Ferrari. But at the same time, that's really how these projects become successful is wow, hey guys, you did a great job. We're gonna come into, you know, the second phase now. So it's just an interesting way to kind of approach it. Going through steps for infrastructure planning prior to Power BI's actual components being deployed. You know, you think that would be pretty self-explanatory, but sometimes you don't always think through what is the architecture gonna take. you know, do you have a massive amount of data that you might need to put a data warehouse in place? Or do you have this, maybe some archaic data warehouse that needs a little bit of love? And you need to do some things to get it cleaned up before you even engage on the Power BI project. You can do a lot in parallel, you know, these days, but at the same time, it's really important to get your ducks in a row, do the proper planning, don't rush it. And again, there might be some, you know, Azure services, there might be some cloud, AWS, whatever it might be, there might be a mixture of that. There might be some on-prem systems. You know, we work with some banks and some oil and gas companies that their legal team will not let them store data in the cloud. They call it possession and control. Seismic data, that's the lifeblood of their business. They're not going to store where they're drilling their, you know, cool new stuff in the cloud. So, you know, with that, you always got to plan for on-prem as well. Even though, again, on-prem is, you know, less and less, it's just really important to think through that whole kind of life cycle. Implementation roadmap, outlining the steps, specific steps in 6-month increments. So really take it 6 months at a time. What are we gonna do in this first 6 months? What are our goals? It's funny, I always kind of talking to clients, say, okay, let's, Mr. Client, Ms. Client, if this project is successful, what's it gonna look like in 6 months from now? You know, what's gonna check that box to say we did a good job? And really it goes down to the last bullet. You know, how do we say, okay, what do you guys expect, guys or gals expect in 6 months? And what is this project gonna look like? You know, is this gonna have 15 change orders? It shouldn't, right? You should be able to plan for it so you don't have to change order the client. And a lot of organizations have internal IT folks that don't have to engage external, you know, consultants. But at the same time, even if you're working internal, at your, you know, you're an IT folk, a person that works for a company, you still don't wanna have to ask for more budget at that same time. So just really important there. Developing a Power BI Center of Excellence. Before I jump into that, you guys have any questions? You guys are easy. I'm sorry, yep. Yeah, great question. So the question is, have you ever had a issue where you had like a mixed model, like a self-service and a corporate BI, where you had to have kind of a hybrid of the two? And the answer is all the time. And I would plan for a hybrid because there's always gonna be some on-prem data sources, or you might wanna take archive data at some point and get that stuff off there. So a good deal of hybrid type of approaches for that. And that's where even the planning is even more important. So yeah, it's absolutely doable, a hybrid model. Sometimes it's the most cost effective. Just always plan for a little bit of hybrid, bucket it, you know, here's 20 hours of hybrid possibility. It's gonna save you a lot in the long run. Yeah, yeah. Do you have a question?
What do you recommend when part of your X month plan or vision is actually dependent on the roadmap of the tool itself?
Yeah.
And how often do you revisit that or adjust?
Sure, yeah. Yeah, so I guess the question was, how often do we plan a roadmap where maybe the tool is evolving and we can't necessarily say, okay, this is gonna be, right. Great question. So I would never try to say we're gonna roll out something X by X date. I would always give it 2 or 3 months of being in production. We have a whole side of consulting. We're doing SharePoint consulting still. We do SharePoint 2019 implementations. And I can remember the other day we told a client, just do SharePoint 2016. 2019 still has some issues. But at the same time, I think try to give it some time. Give it 3 or 4 months before you actually implement something. You wanna be bleeding edge, but have a proof of concept environment. Test it out. Don't have any kind of live maybe data going in that, or any kind of production data that would be reliant on a new functionality that maybe Microsoft can't quite guarantee. Does that help?
Do you have, or can you recommend like a templated governance strategy that maybe a company could take and tweak to make their own, so we kind of have a starting place?
Sure, yeah. Absolutely. So the very last slide, I have my email address on here. And so that's something I was going to offer. And so if you, if anybody wants to email me, we have a little kind of templated governance plan, and I'll shoot it over to you. And I have Amy, Errin, Chris, and Karina back here. We'll all kind of shoot it to you. And yeah, but we do have that. Yeah.
What was the question?
Oh, I'm sorry. It was, do you have a templated governance strategy that you could maybe share? So you bet. Sorry. Yeah. Long day. Any other questions? Yep. Sorry. That's a great question. So the question is, how many power users per capita, basically? X amount of users, how many power users? So depending on, again, on the vertical, on the sensitivity of the data, all of that good stuff, we always say one power user to 45 to 50 users. So that's gonna keep them pretty busy. If you can have one per department, that would be optimal. That's the go-to, but typically not everybody can say, I can give you one power user. So one power user to 50 users is kind of a good litmus test. Yeah, that's $1 million question right there. Is the question was, we want to roll out a self-service model, but it typically requires a pro license, and we don't want to have to procure that many pro licenses, but still be able to share the reports, right? So, you know, there's no real, they summarize it okay there. So, you know, you can, SharePoint Online is great for embedding that. They still will need a license. We've done some pretty cool stuff with embedding Power BI reports inside of SharePoint. There's a little bit of gray area in the licensing aspect. So there's some things you can do there. you can also pass through some credentials, depending on if you have another provider. You could possibly do that as well. So I'd be happy to maybe walk through your use case afterwards, and I can kind of maybe talk through some possibilities there. I still have a nasty gram from Microsoft about some gray area licensing I did recently. What do you mean they didn't get 200 Power BI Pro licenses? All right. Jumping forward, establishing a Power BI Center of Excellence is a cutting edge approach. It really is to achieve a cohesive, strategic, and scalable enterprise-wide Power BI environment. We've all heard of Center of Excellence, COE. It's been around a long time. I don't mean to keep harping on SharePoint, but did a lot of SharePoint COEs back in the day. Knowledge management, COE, communities of practice, all of those kind of terms, I think people kind of think all those together. But, it's really five core elements. It's defining your development model that I kind of talked about earlier, defining a Power BI governance model, a strategy for Power BI training and user adoption, which I'm going to beat to death today. A clear development and configuration standards for Power BI, and then a Power BI solution architecture framework so that you can explain to it to possible folks that might be interested in it within your organization. So those are the five core elements. Again, I'll share my email address. I have probably 10 decks on just these bullets alone, but again, kind of summarize it, what it would look like. We got about, what are we doing here? About 10 minutes going on here. So in looking at developing a Power BI chargeback model, I don't know, I'm 10 minutes away from everyone's booze here, so I'll hurry up. So Power BI chargeback models. So this is interesting because it's implementing a Power BI chargeback model to ensure that the cost of Power BI licenses, as well as any related consulting services, are planned for and are funded, right? And so it's interesting because Office 365 might have this, custom applications, like Workday, for example. That's a good application that has got some cool chargeback stuff. And so if you are using X amount of different features, you should, depending on the amount of users or the type of data or the number of reports, maybe your department has to pay $500 a month to IT to fund Power BI and the custom development. And so there's some numbers as far as, you know, number of users, all this good stuff, as far as what a chargeback model would be. But there's the flip side to a chargeback model that's so cool is it ensures that each department, you know, is bearing the cost of it, but it provides for not only that clear defined budget, but you're able to put a face with the name. So you're able to say, well, okay, so-and-so in HR, so-and-so in marketing, so-and-so in IT, so-and-so in sales, these are the key stakeholders. You could automatically wrap them into your governance because you know who they are now. You know who's going to actually be using it. And so you'd be surprised how many folks would say yes to a chargeback model if you say, well, this is the only way we're going to be able to fund this project. Throw it out there, make it a small number, and maybe it grows 10%, 15% every year. But it's a really nice way to have Power BI pay for itself. It's a nice way to your self-service question around Power BI Pro licenses. Sometimes with the overall organization paying for some of that, it really makes a difference. And also best practice roadmap and planning. A lot of organizations will hold off on key elements or phases of a Power BI implementation due to cost constraints. And so if you're saying, well, we're not going to be able to do this for the entire organization unless everybody ponies up X amount of funds, and it may be a very small number, but just getting them to have some, you know, skin in the game kind of situation brings, this mindset of, okay, we're in, we're going to make this successful. Sometimes they tend to offer up power users to that as well. Hey, well, we're getting charged for it. We want to have somebody at least who knows what's going on, so we're going to have them go to the meetings. So again, different ways to kind of reverse engineer some of this, but you know, these chargeback models really do pay off. Sometimes they're a tough sell, but try, because it will pay off. A couple other pieces here. Power BI roadmap will help ensure the platform's long-term success, as I've mentioned, but in getting into that, future scalability, right? So when a best practices Power BI chargeback model is put in place, the various stakeholders in the organization will become more on board because it drives the roadmap. And what I mean by that is really, you know, it includes these conversations that can sometimes otherwise be put off around future planning. So it allows for long-term strategies, more thought-out strategies. It does really kind of bring conversations to bear that wouldn't have happened before. It's key for compatibility, future scalability, things like Power BI Embedded, companies that have cool custom apps out there that might want to service their clients and they want to, you know, wrap Power BI around that. That's a whole heck of a lot easier to do a chargeback model that way too. And also, again, it helps for stronger governance because folks want to identify the key players. Hey, we're paying for it. I want Bill or Susie or Bob to be a part of that. And with that, again, you're going to be able to align those team members, like I mentioned, you know, with the different departments themselves. So that is my last slide. I talked a little fast, which I tend to do. So I have questions. To your question about the governance, if you guys want to shoot me an email, guys and gals, shoot me an email. You can go to epcgroup.net. It was enterpriseprojectconsulting.com back in 2003, and people said your URL is way, way too long. So it's now epcgroup.net, and my business partner, Errin, actually named that. I've got a book signing after this, and so at the Microsoft bookstore, there'll be 150 books that Microsoft has been kind enough to have. And then also, they said because of the amount they were shipped, they have 200 more books they're going to send. So if you guys bring this card and get the information to some of the folks here, we can mail you a free book, the new Power BI book. And then also on the flip side, kind of another deal we're doing, if you want to be the first folks to use it, powerbitraining.com is launching in the fourth quarter. I've got a green screen and I'm doing all sorts of fun Power BI training. So, feel free to check it out, comment. You know, we're very passionate about Power BI, but thank you all for joining today and appreciate your time.